la 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 da 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 da
I love the instrumental. Da 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 da. That's beautiful. That is beautiful. Da 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 da. Thank you. That's beautiful. I love it. I love it. You know, I told you yesterday that actually this week, I have 2 weeks. I'm going to endeavor to talk, create the atmosphere on this greatest gift of all, the gift that keeps on giving. It is the gift of Jesus, the greatest expression of love for mankind. So what I have done is to create the ambience. This ambience that I've created is to allow that to be a ministry to you. You know, over the topics, you know, one topic I'm talking about is love. This month, I don't want to talk about the pandemic. I'm talking about love, the love of God, the love for one another. You know, the greatest gift that God, you know, that need to be connected, interconnected. But the greatest expression of it does not come from, you know, doesn't come from what we manufacture, what we do, what we start. It begins from God. And if we don't know it God's way, whatever we try to manufacture in our way does not last. Our flowers will never last. Chocolate will never last. A brand new Mercedes will never last. Even a house will never last. So many things that we try to do, but what will last is knowing that first and foremost we have the love of God. So what makes this entire event, this entire month so special, people are traveling and working so hard to raise so much money, to do so much good. And all of that's good. We're supposed to do it. It's been embedded on the inside of us to care and love and be there for the people that mean a lot to us. But how much more if we bring in a dimension of the Almighty God? the reason for the season is Christ born to express the greatest love, the greatest kindness, the greatest power, the greatest redemption. And if that doesn't affect you first, I don't know what kind of love will ever affect you and you feel it and moves you. So what I'm endeavoring, whatever you hear in the background, is to bring in that little melody of Christmas as I teach, or what I have. I said I'm going to endeavor from the, you know, 3 days. This is the third day. And look, my title that I've been entitling this is Love is a Patient. I told you 2 days ago that love is a patient in need of healthcare. And I told you that love needs two things. There's two things for it to happen. Number one, it needs a caretaker and a caregiver. If you don't have these two, there's none at all. Nothing. You know? So, which one are you? Are you a caregiver or a caretaker? You can choose whatever you want. But most of all, Jesus becomes the ultimate care giver. He gives us the ultimate, amazing expression of his love. And he covers a multitude of sin. What the first thing that has to happen to express the depth of the grace of God is that it covers a multitude of sin, a multitude of guilt, a multitude of the past. If love cannot heal your past wounds, okay, it has not affected you in the outermost parts of your life, any expression of love that you enter into has to, you know, bring such a love of healing on the inside of you. It brings you to a plateau that you've never been before, an experience you've never had before. It brings such a joy, liberty, peace in the Holy Ghost. And so, you know, if we're going to ever celebrate this wonderful holiday this time, I beg of you, let's begin it with God. Let's begin it with the Almighty God. And if we can do that, we'll see great healing. Someone on here needs great healing. Healing from past pain. Healing from past experiences. So you can enjoy, you know, you can enjoy God, you know, to the uttermost of your life. And today, by the grace of God, I endeavor to share with you the word of the Lord. When you see me do that, that means I'm trying to invite as many people. Please, if you can, invite your friends to share. If this means a lot, if it doesn't mean a lot, no problem. Don't worry about it. You know, what we read the last couple of days, our theme scripture was, love suffers long and is kind, and love does not envy, love does not parade itself, love is not puffed up, it does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, and is not provoked, thinks no evil, does not rejoice in iniquity. In other words, what does that mean? It simply means that when you see your friend or your relatives or whoever going through something, you don't laugh at them, you don't wish them evil, because you are not, you know, you're not open to seeing, you know, people around you go through pain, and you like, you rejoice over them or rejoice because they go through that. Even your enemies. That's why the Bible tells us that we should pray for our enemies. You know, it does not behave rudely, does not seek its own, is not provoked, and thinks no evil. So in other words, it's very secure. Love is very secure. The question is your love secure? Okay? Does your love think evil? Does not rejoice in iniquity, and it rejoices in truth. In other words, the truth that sets you free. The truth that sets me free. So if we are going to get around this great amazing season that we're living in. We want to see people for who they are, for the kindness there, the openness, the transparency that they have. You know, because again, what Jesus did, you know, when he came and he died for us, you know, when he came to die for us, the Bible says he unguarded himself before his disciples and showed himself to them. And he asked Peter 3 times, do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? In other words, I've shown you so much love. I've shown you so much care. I've protected you. I've defended you. I've prayed for you. Do you love me? And the 3 times, it challenged Peter. That was a challenge because he knew that upon this rock he will build his church. But how can you build it, you know, upon this rock, and a rock that does not have a relationship? There has to be a relationship, a deeper relationship. So as we go through this season, I want you to reflect on this one thing. Reflect that the greatest denominator, the greatest guest of honor is Jesus. Yes, we can get excited on the outside to affect ourselves on the inside, but Jesus, like I told you, he affects us on the inside out. Inside out. We affect each other from outside in. He affects us from inside out. In other words, what he does on the inside of our heart is eternal. What we do to be happy and have melody and joy and everything is temporal. It is temporal. So what does he want of us? He wants us to grab a hold of that gift that was given for the human race. He wants us to grab a hold of that truth. He wants us to step in and embrace his peace. The peace that passes all understanding. In other words, let me say it like this. You've gone through turmoil. You've gone through chaos. You've gone through attacks. You've gone through setbacks. You've gone through holdbacks. You've gone through so much. There hasn't been peace in your spirit, in your heart. And then here comes a day where people are celebrating, going around and just giving gifts and everything. You know, I have several people who are, you know, who have birthdays and everything, and it's exciting. And all of a sudden, you know, that gift will come in and that gift will go, or will dispel and everything like that. Everybody's looking for something. Everybody's looking for a connection that brings such a great impact of joy and peace. But is the peace you're searching for everlasting? Will you maintain it all the way through? The only way you can maintain it is when you grab a hold of the source. And that source is Jesus Christ. That source is Jesus Christ. I told you a story yesterday. You know, very impactful story. I told you, meeting this couple who had been married for almost 65 years. Unbelievable, but believable. I normally use that word, unbelievable, but believable, because I got to see it. I get to see it a lot. And I asked them a question. What has kept you together? You've loved this one individual. You know, what has kept you together with this individual? And they told me 3 things that I'll never forget. Okay, 3 things that I'll never forget. Number one, they say, we both decided to support each other's visions. Each other. We both decided to support each other's idea of who we are. What she came with, the uniqueness she came with, the man was supportive of it. And what he came with, the woman, the wife supported it. And then whatever brought them together, which was this crescendo of love, they came together on it. Look at that. So they're in support of each other's uniqueness, and they're in support of each other for what brings them together, what makes this whole thing unique. So I say, is that the reason why you kept him? What about the ups and downs? I say, well, I didn't even care about the ups and downs because I saw he had an intent. He was very intent on making sure that my desires are met, and I was making sure that his desires are met. And we make sure that all what brings us together, we do it with such a level of enthusiasm and happiness. And so therefore, they work through their differences, they work through their ups and downs, and their love, and they're almost like 80s, like almost going to 90. That was something that made me marvel a lot, because they started something and they've lived through, they've raised grandchildren and grandchildren to see such a life, and they've taken this very blessing and generational blessing to their children's children. Why is that unique? Because love can actually inflict or affect. It can affect or inflict. It can cause you to be a victim. It can cause you to have joy. Okay? The love of our world. Now, when we go to God's love, God affects us with his love. You know, he affects us so deeply that he places a DNA on us. Okay? His love alters and changes our identity, brings us back. It actually reconciles us back to God. That's how powerful the love of God is. The agape, the phileo, you know, all of the types of love. God comes in and say, you know what? My type of love will heal your inner pain, your inner wounds. And after I heal you completely, I will place you and position you in a place that you're able to receive again or love again. Is that possible? Yeah, it is possible. Is it possible? So what you call Mary, Merry Christmas, for me is what I term this inner word or inward Merry Christmas. When your heart is in excitement, when your heart is in celebration, when your life is meaningful, when you're open to God's goodness because you see how he's affecting you, you are his blessing, you are his number one, you're the apple of his eye, he loves you, he needs you, he's jealous for you. He is jealous for you. Remember that song we sing? You are special to God. He's mindful of you. Okay? He sent his son, you know, here, a priceless gift on you. Why are you special to God that way? Why are you special to God that way? That he can do everything to open up the heavens to bless you that way. That's how unique you are. And if I can remind you that, that will be your merry heart. You have a merry heart. You have a merry heart. And in this season, I'm going to endeavor to make sure that all your pain and all your worry and all your fears and everything the enemy would have wanted to sabotage your life, it does not go through. You are going to start 2021 with an amazing experience of the fullness of God like you've never had it before. Amen? You understand? Because love does not rejoice in iniquity, but rejoices in truth, bears all things, believes all things, and hopes all things, and endures all things. That's what I call the patient. Because in the end of the day, when you go through that patient, you know, the healthcare provider, which is God, comes in and begins to give you. You have to go through the process. That's why yesterday I began to teach about the test. The number one, you know, the love test, number one, I opened up to you, the test of time. There has to be a test of time. You've got to, I don't care when you started it. 20 years later, like the couple that I told you, 65 years later, the test of time, they've endured. That's amazing. Time will test every relationship. time will test. Not the infatuation, not the excitement, but the time. All right? That's very important. And that's what reveals your willpower. It reveals the strength of your heart, the security of your heart, the trust of your heart. All right? That even when it's not the happy days, you're enduring and you're going through. You've seen the storms. You've seen everything. It is. You endure it. It's a test of time. Tell me who you are in love with and I'll tell you how long you will survive. Because you'll be tested by time. And what does that mean? How I can expand on time? It is the events that happen from the day you begin and the destiny you're going to take. Those events will be full of joys, will be full of challenges, will be full of everything, and the person or the human being that you've opened your heart to will still say, I still care, I still love you, I'm still here, I'll defend you, I'll protect you, I will walk with you, I will pray for you, I'll lay hands on you, we'll sing together, we'll dance together, we'll cry together, we'll go through everything, the test of time. But Jesus even does it better. Because when the fullness of time had come, Jesus was born. And what was the greatest ultimate test? It was the cross. He endured the cross. He endured it. Oh. Can we endure love? Can our love suffer towards the cross? You're pinned here, and especially when you're innocent, especially when you've not done nothing. Because a lot of times, you know, it's when you've done something. It's when you feel you've been victimized and everything like that. How are you doing, son? Davis? But Jesus comes to hang himself, you know, to be on the cross. For something he's never done in order to redeem you who has done it. How do you have this love exchange where somebody takes your faults and your blames and your weaknesses and your flaws and everything and it says they belong to me? Who's ever done that for you? Your pain becomes his pain. Your tears become their tears. Your downfall becomes his holding hands. When you're down, he wants to pick you up. When you cry, he wants to wipe your tears away. When you're challenged, you need a breakthrough, financial breakthrough, and you're going through, you feel like you're alone, and he's always there. What kind of love is this? What kind of love is this? You hear me, saints? And if I start to break it down real good for you, you will find out that you're so loved of God. Amazingly, intricately, that you ought to rejoice and celebrate over it. Don't even try to put religion on it. This, what I'm talking about, don't even try to put religion, just because you read the Bible too much, don't put religion on it. Because if you put religion on it, it'll only be a mindset of your Sundays. But this is a real expression so deep that it heals every part, every essence of who you are. Because if this is how Christmas affects us so much, if this is how we, you know, we go through such a zeal and time and money and everything, then how much more can we go for God like this? How much more can we go for God? So I talked about the test of time, the test of knowledge. That's when you grow to know somebody and appreciate them for who they are. Number one, they're human. Number one, they're real. They live right here. I talked about that. And then I talked about focus, attention. I want to go back for those of you who missed it. Your attention, your scale of focus, where is it? It's part of the expression of your love, because you cannot fall in love with something that you don't pay attention to. You would never do that. You never fall in love with anybody that you don't pay attention to. If that's the case, and pretty much as I've been counseling and talking to people, you know, who have fallen in love and fallen out of love, most of the time their cries and tears are about, he lost attention, he doesn't see me. We live in the same house, he does not see me at all. And once the attention span is gone, that means that the person that was so important to you, the person you paid attention to, is no longer that there. And that's the most painful experience that you get to see that affects people. It becomes a wound and it attaches itself on them because the attention that they once received is no longer there. See, that's why we call it Merry Christmas. We never forget it. We never forget it. It's there. We pay attention to it. We hear the music. I'm listening to music right now. You hear me sing? So the test of attention. And then number four is the test of security. I think I ended there yesterday. It's building security and not wishful thinking. I'm talking about real security. You see, you cannot lay your heart in a place that you're not feeling the strength of your security. And with security comes with trust. You cannot feel secure until you trust. And trust is what? Trust is exchange of truth. Where there's truth, there's trust, there's security. Where there's truth, there's trust, there's security. Where there's security, there is trust, there's truth. So all three, and then there is love. So once the truth is there, there's trust, there's security, and the more, the ambience of love. You understand that? Where there is love, when security is in place and love is poured out, there is such a level of peace, joy in the Holy Ghost. The joy in your spirit. In other words, you don't have to look behind your back. You're not living. You're not paranoid about the person. You know, Jesus is not paranoid about us. He's not paranoid. In other words, when you have trust, you do not expect bad things to happen to you in the process. But today, do you know how many people are paranoid, expecting something bad? Because of the experiences they've gone through in some places or other people, they're very paranoid that it's going to happen again. They've used me, they've lied to me, they've wounded me, they've betrayed me, they've gone through that. And so I don't trust anymore. I can open my heart, I've got it. So therefore, when you've got it, there's no love, there's no trust. Guess what? Everything's so broken. Your spirit is so hurt and broken, and there's no peace. There's no peace. So therefore tonight, the test, and a lot of people struggle with that, is trust and security. Everybody's looking for security. I used to be afraid of the dark when I was younger. So when I went to the market, you know, to the grocery store, you know, remember those days, I was so afraid of the dark. But eventually the older I got and I figured out that I was only scared about my imagination. What scared me was my own imagination of what I thought was there. And so many people are caught up with that negative imagination of what they think is there or what they imagine or perceive that is going, might happen. And when your mind conceives that it's wrong things that are going to happen to you, you begin to attract those things. You cannot love when you expect bad things are going to happen to you. Don't ever prophesy your process to be so negative because you might get it. It might happen to you. Oh, Michael, you know what? I don't want to be naive. You know, yeah, I got to be. Yeah, you're right. You being not naive is this, is you trust you. The one thing that I've told people who have come to me for counseling and everything is that the first person to trust is you. If you can trust yourself, you can go anywhere and feel secure. Most people begin by trusting the other, but I tell people, trust you. Trust me. I trust Michael. I trust Michael Kingsley so well. In other words, can nothing get come from outside to contaminate who I am? I'm so unsure about me. And that's what gives me such a great joy to walk in any place, around any people, you know. And if anything goes wrong, it would be because I pulled it off. It's because I was so secure around me that I could be able to see. Because when you're so secure about who you are, you're able to see through the spirit. You're able to see through, your eyes will see through everything. Your eyes will know. Your heart will know. But when you're paranoid, no trust, no nothing, you're everywhere, you will not have the level of discernment to know. You won't. This is good for somebody. So therefore tonight, it's a test of security. You know? Number five, it is the test of problem solving. Everybody wants to fall in love. Everybody wants to see this free will, free fall, easy way of opening up and all that. The part that's easy, you know? But then there's a part that's work. You've got to work for it. You've got to work for it. It ain't free. It ain't free. Actually, it's a test of love. It's a test of work. There has to be an element of mutual, it's called the mutual benefit. And all these processes that I'm talking to you about, the test of time, the test of time, the test of knowledge, the test of focus, the test of security, you know, the test of work and problem solving. Jesus expressed all of these in order to show, express his love for us. He went through the test of time. He proved it. The test of, you know, he said, for those he knew, he foreknew, and he predestined into adoption. So guess what? He foreknew us. He paid attention to us. The test of security. I mean, I can give you scripture from Genesis and Revelation that it shows and proves that he didn't just die for us, but he also died to protect us from the evil one. He came to destroy the works of the intruder. That's security. And we are so assured of his security. We are so assured of God's security to push the enemy away from our path. That's a test of security. Test of work. He showed us on the cross how it should be done. Glory to God. Glory to God. Amen. And the test of solving, problem solving. And that's what I was touching on. There is an easy part, but you've got to be a man or woman of God that you're called to solve problems. Most people like the part that's easy. And once they get to a place where they're supposed to fix problems, or they think that the problem's going to fix themselves, I would rather tell young people, I say, right, before you open your heart to anyone, ask them, how are they problem solvers? If a problem arises, if a challenge, a storm, a crisis arises, would they be able to stand? Would they have solutions for it? When Jesus saw a crisis, he came to solve it. It was a sin problem. It was a sin crisis. He came to solve it. You want to be a friend of someone who is a problem solver. Are you? Are you a problem solver? I know you say, oh yeah, I'm a great lover, but are you a problem solver? Are you one that will say, you know what? God has called me to be a blessing to somebody. Are you willing to go in somebody's life and say, you know what? What's going on in your life and how can I be of help? How can I alleviate everything that you're going through? What can I do to be a blessing to you? Oh, it'll be a blessing. It'll be a blessing for you to see and express yourself around people and be a blessing. How good are you and not run away from problems. Don't ever open your heart from somebody who sees a crisis and then run away. No. They stay. They fix it. That's why they signed up for it. But if they're going to run away, there's no security. They have no stamina. They have no, what you know, in British English, they have no stamina. The greatest expression Jesus showed us when he was fixing this sin problem, he stayed on the cross, even when it was so hard, when he sweat tears of blood, even when he prayed and said, Lord, he prayed about the cup if it'd be taken away from him. But not, I said, not my will, but your will. And he endured it and he said, it is finished. It is finished. There is that part in this expression of this, what we call a merry heart, that is part of fixing problems. Part of fixing problems or solving problems. Oh, Michael, I don't want to get messy. Solving people's problems is so messy. Yes, it is. So did Jesus fix yours? Did Jesus say it's messy? So when you have people that only want to celebrate the good part of you or the good part of the situation, and when crisis happens, they were never there in the first place. But God has given us the spirit of power. That's why the scripture here that I want to give you before I close will be a blessing to you. First Peter will be a blessing to you in the name of Jesus. Glory to God, glory to God. Chapter 4 and verse 8. And above all things, have fervent love for one another. What is fervent love? In other words, have a purpose-driven relationship. Or let me call it another word for that. Fervent love is enthusiasm. It's like when you're expressing yourself around somebody. Just like we are excited about buying gifts for our loved ones and everything. We're excited about it. God say, there should be fervent and enthusiastic expression about the people we care for. Because that's how Jesus was so much enthusiastic to say, I'm going to get rid of sin. I'm going to get rid of the devil. I'm going to get rid of sickness and disease. I'm going to open blind eyes so that I can get back my people to me. That is so sweet. Now, I have somebody ask me right now, he says, is that even possible? That's like dreamland. It never happens. There's no Chris Cheming no more. Amen? Yes, 1 Peter 4, chapter 8. Chapter 4, verse 8. He says, above all things, glory to God, have fervent love for one another. For who? For one another. That's a challenge. What if they may not accept me? What if they are not like me? They don't look like me. He said, have fervent love. What makes the difference is that when we look at the cross of Jesus and the expression of his love, we remove the barriers of color, race, language, and everything, and we are open to embrace one another in the love of Jesus. So, do we want to cure the patient? How do we cure this patient that suffers long? It is everything that I just mentioned to you. It's just everything that I just mentioned to you. Do we want to cure the patient? The patient can be cured. The patient can be cured. Their heart can be revived again, can be resuscitated again, they can believe again. The wounds of disappointment can be defeated, can be broken away in the name of Jesus. The patient of love can be cured again, and they can feel again, they can love again, they can rejoice again, and they can be themselves again. Do you agree? Somebody say amen to that. For love will cover a multitude of sin. What? What will it do? It'll cover a multitude of sin. It'll cover a multitude of wrong. It'll override everything. Just like Jesus' love toward me and you overrode everything. In other words, you're supposed to be rich in forgiveness already, not after. Because if you don't walk in that, then you're going to walk in bitterness. So tonight, I just gave you another snippet for today to share with you and let you know love covers a multitude of sin. Why is it important? Because it's important that you walk in forgiveness. It's important that you walk in forgiveness. This season, if it means a lot to you, it means the Son of God came to redeem you and I. You might be able to redeem others, forgive others, heal from within. Let you, the patient of love, who's been victimized and gone through a lot, be healed in the name of Jesus. That was my message tonight. I hope you got some sense out of it. It can be a blessing to you. Share this with somebody that's going through a lot. Because Jesus is the reason for the expression of this great love. Do something like this and say, Lord, I accept you in my heart, and above all, I accept your love in my heart. Let it fill every part of me. Let it heal every part of me. Set me free in the name of Jesus, and my life will never be the same again. Let me believe again, hope again, in the name of Jesus. Amen and amen. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you again on tomorrow. Announcements, my friends, next Sunday evening at 5, right here in the United States, Louisville City, our church, and my pastor friend church, we have a prophetic evening, very powerful, it's coming up, get ready for it. We're going to televise it live on Facebook, and then the week after that we have another event also. I think we believe in God for great and mighty things. And then I'll give you different other announcements regarding the World Trumpet TV and all that. God bless you. Love you. And I hope to hear from you or see you again on tomorrow.